Hello everyone, welcome to the Script webinar. My name is Renee Chen and I'm your moderator today. In the next 40 minutes, we'll introduce a proven methodology to roll out the CSMS and show you how to prepare for vehicle type approval using proof. Please note that all participants are muted to avoid background noise. You're welcome to ask questions all the time during the presentation. They will be answered in the Q&A session afterwards. Please use the Q&A chat box to type in your questions. They will be collected, so even if we run out of time today, we will still get back to you afterwards. Now, I would like to hand over the speaker role to Moritz, the product manager of Proof at Script, and Jan, the senior manager of KPMG. Jan, Moritz, please take it away.
Thank you so much, Renee. And thank you all for your participation. It's amazing to see so many of you here, and it's a pleasure to present the topic to you today. My name is Moritz Winslow, and I spent more than 10 years in cybersecurity, consulting clients almost always in the automotive domain, worldwide, from specialized suppliers to top five OEMs, including right now three projects where I'm involved in supporting OEMs implementing the WP29 requirements. I'm also a Script business owner for the CSMS services, so I'm really happy to present the topic to you today.
Yeah, and welcome from my side as well. I'm very happy and excited to be able to present you the webinar on how to achieve CSMS certification and cybersecurity vehicle type approval together with my colleague Moritz from Script. I would like to introduce myself with just a few words. My name is Jan Stölting. I'm senior manager at KPMG Germany, and I'm supporting our clients in the area of cybersecurity for more than 10 years. My clients are either in automotive, but also non-automotive, for instance, within pharma, banking, telecommunication, and much more. My core skills are in implementing security management system and building up cyber defense security operations, as well as managing big security transformation program. For instance, I'm just leading a three-year-long compliance-driven security transformation program where our client needs to cover several or broad range of cybersecurity requirements to manage cyber risks, and I do see very much similarity to this exercise here as well. You may wonder why we are two people on the call from two different companies, Script and KPMG. Maybe it's worth, Moritz, that you illuminate on our cooperation.
Yes, thank you, Jan. And I'm actually quite excited to do this together with you and our partners of KPMG in Germany. I think it's the first time at Script we do this co-hosted webinar. By the way, for everyone, Jan and I plan to be in the same room for this webinar. Due to the COVID-19 situation, this has turned out not to be feasible, so we have a little bit of an additional complexity to master today. But let me share some brief words on our partnership. So from the ESCO point of view, we have over a decade of experience in automotive security engineering, taking security from initial standardization discussions and concept ideas all the way to mass production and security operations. But much like a sailing team needs many different skills to master the high seas, we see that the same is true for implementing now a CSMS. There are many different competencies that need to come together, and this is why we have partnered with KPMG. So what KPMG brings to the table from our point of view at Script is over 20 years of experience in establishing security management systems across many different industries. And of course, they have a very strong and well-known brand for achieving certification and compliance topics. So let's have a look at the agenda for today. And we have such a diverse audience today that we split it in multiple parts and so hope to address some of the points and questions that all of you have. In the end, we will also have a Q&A section, as Renee already mentioned. So we begin with an introduction to CSMS and vehicle type approval, so we have a good foundation and the shared terminology here. And we will then dive into one of the exciting parts for us today, at least. We've already started supporting OEMs and suppliers in implementing the requirements, as I mentioned earlier. So we want to share some of the market observations we have, some of the industry trends we see, some of the developments, the big topics that pop up again and again in the project. And based on this, in the third section, we want to talk about PROOF. This is a framework that we've developed at KPMG and S-Script. PROOF stands for Product Security Organization Framework, and it can help exactly in this situation to optimize your approach to build up a CSMS and prepare for vehicle type approval. And then before we go to the Q&A, we will have a brief look beyond the CSMS and the vehicle type approval itself to what else is out there. So let us start with the first section. And to begin, I want to take one step back from security. So the automotive industry is going through a tremendous change from new mobility business models to the future of connected and automated driving. And you don't need me to tell you this, of course. In all of this, security has become a necessity to realize this future, and this view is also increasingly shared by regulatory and standardization bodies. So what we see are globally, on international level, national level, even sub-national level, an increasing number of activities to standardize and regulate automotive cybersecurity. And this means manufacturers and suppliers alike are faced with an increasingly complex regulatory landscape.
Yeah, Moritz, we at KPMG have seen very similar developments before in other industries with an increasingly complex regulatory landscape. For instance, take banking into account. After the bank crisis, the bank authority forced financial institutes to comply with a broad range of new requirements, mostly related to risk management and especially cyber risk management. And as a consequence, banks were forced to build management systems in order to manage their cyber risks. And I wouldn't necessarily say it's good news, but at least you may profit from those experiences and challenges these companies faced during their journey.
Yes, and this is exactly the motivation from ESCO's point of view behind the partnership, right? So to profit from the insights in many industries from establishing security management systems, but in a way that is relevant to the automotive specifics. So let us go over and look at the requirements coming down from the UNECE WP29 and how the 21434 fits into the picture. We'll start with the WP29. It is the World Forum for Harmonization of Vehicle Regulation, and it does exactly this. So it passes international agreements, so-called UN regulations, and there's already well over 100 UN regulations so far. This WP29 has now set up a task force for cybersecurity and over-the-air issues, the TFCSOTA, whose objective is to develop a new regulation for cybersecurity. By now, this regulation is almost finished, and it will target vehicle types M and N, so primarily passenger vehicles and trucks for transportation of goods. The plan is to adopt this regulation under the 1958 agreement. You can see the contracting parties of this 1958 agreement on the world map on the bottom right. And you can see that large parts of the automotive world, or really a large part of the world, are contracting parties of the 1958 agreement, and there are already firm plans, for example, by the EU and Japan to implement this upcoming regulation. So what's in that regulation? It will put cybersecurity into the vehicle type approval. You can see a very high-level sketch here on the right-hand side. So basically, what happens is OEMs, before they can bring new vehicle types into the market, such as EU or Japan, they go through a type approval. They go to a technical service, provide a sample vehicle, potentially also some technical documentation, and the technical service does a validation and sends a test report to a national approval authority. So in Germany, the national approval authority is the Kraftfahrtbundesamt. In the Netherlands, it's the RDW, but these are always national authorities. And then these grant a type approval, and the vehicle type is now approved to be sold in that market. Because these are international agreements, under the 1958 agreement, There's a concept of mutual agreement, so you don't have to do this country by country. For example, within the EU, one type approval in one member country is sufficient. So what are the cybersecurity requirements? What is the new regulation about? The first requirement is that OEMs need to implement a cybersecurity management system. So a full process landscape for managing cybersecurity risks, starting with risk identification, assessing, categorizing, treating risks, verifying appropriate risk management, testing mitigations that they work, keeping all of this up to date, to do continuous monitoring, to respond within a reasonable time frame. So the focus is really here to cover the entire life cycle, and the target is the vehicle type. And here we are back to the relation of cybersecurity, information security management systems. They share a lot of similarities, and Jan will later talk more about this. So this is the first requirement, and what OEMs in the future will have to show a type approval, they will have to show a CSMS certificate. So these processes meet the certification in the future. What's the second requirement? The second requirement is vehicle type security. It's basically the application of the CSMS of these processes to the vehicle type during development. So this means during the type approval, there needs to be some technical documentation that shows exactly this application. One more note, because the regulation itself is targeting OEMs, like you see here. This is the vehicle type approval is for OEMs, but OEMs are required to manage dependencies with suppliers and service providers. And we've already observed many instances of, we've analyzed about a dozen cases where OEMs already break down these requirements onto the OEM supplier relationship and this interface. So while the regulation does not target the suppliers directly, we see a clear market trend that suppliers will also need to implement some form of cybersecurity management. Let us put this into context with the 21434. So here again, we have the two main requirements from the WP29, the cybersecurity management system, and the vehicle type security, which is basically an application of the CSMS during development. And the regulation basically defines the what. It has about 20 requirements, so it's fairly high level. And it's split basically between the enterprise part or the organizational overall part with the CSMS and the project part, the vehicle type of security, which of course has to be repeated for every vehicle type. Next to it are several activities, primarily also the ISO SAE 21434 that goes more into the how to do it. The 21434 contains about 160 requirements how to build up cybersecurity processes across the lifecycle. And it also knows the concept of this enterprise overall level, more the organization-wide view and the project level. There are concepts of cybersecurity audits and cybersecurity assessment, and these concepts can also be used as a baseline to collect and generate evidence for your CSMS and the vehicle type security. The 21434 is not the only activity here. There's also the Jasper Cybersecurity Quality Assurance Guide that does a more deeper dive into aspects of incident response. Important to understand at this point is that neither the 21434 nor the WP29 has a final defined criteria how to do audits or how to do certification. So there's actually a third pillar of activities that are about defining criteria for certification for these audits and assessments. For example, at the German VDA, there are activities for CSMS certification and for the cybersecurity assessment in the context of an ASPICE extension, but there's also plans to start a new ISO activity for criteria for the cybersecurity audit. Also important to understand, most of these activities are still in draft status. So this actually poses then one of the challenges we observe in the market now. There's always the question how to achieve certification. At the same time, the certification criteria are not finalized yet. So this is one of the topics that have to be addressed, this uncertainty. Let us also look, as the last thing in the first section, at the timeline. So we just came out last summer or out of a test phase for this UN regulation. OEMs could take part in this one to do a mock vehicle type approval. Now, early this year then, the 21434 had its first public draft published in February, and we already see a big uptick in new project requests in activities at OEMs and suppliers alike to align the processes here to the standard. The UN regulation itself also still in draft status. The plans are to adopt the final text in the June meeting of the WP29. So this is when we hope to be looking at the final text. And for the ISO SAE 21434, the expectation, our expectation is that it might be around early 2021. So to be sure, to be fair, this is not an official communication from the ISO SAE itself. This is our understanding of our expectation of what will happen in this early 2021. And then let's go further to the future, to the right-hand side. Two of the most crucial dates, July 2022 and July 2024. On these dates, July 2022, the EU plans to apply this regulation to new vehicle types. So from this point on, to bring new vehicle types into the EU market, the CSMS certification has to be provided to a technical service from the OEM. This is then extended 2 years later to first registrations, meaning it also applies then to existing vehicle types, legacy vehicle types that are already been fully developed and are now just continue to be sold. Also in the July 2024 deadline, from this point on, vehicle types must have been developed according to a CSMS. And calculating back typical automotive development times, this means we're getting closer and closer to the point where OEMs need to have set up compliant processes and a compliant CSMS to be able to apply it to the vehicle development. And this is what I want to share in this first section, and maybe Jan, you can do a summary.
Yeah, thanks, Moritz. Yeah, let me summarize this section on the rather regulatory-driven background. First of all, vehicle security regulations and standards become mandatory for all OEMs and indirectly suppliers as well in EU from 2022 onwards. The requirements are on enterprise level, rather reflecting the CSMS, as well as the application of the CSMS on project level, covering the vehicle type approval. Requirements, either in regulations or in standards, are still in draft and not yet finalized. And as well, these requirements, as at least for the WP29, are a very high level, and the ISO 21434 provides more concrete requirements and can be very supportive in terms of implementations. And worth to note that WP29 refer already to the standards in their interpretation, to this standard in their interpretation document. Let's be clear. Without having an implemented and functional CSMS, a type approval of vehicles is not possible and will ultimately affect sales of vehicles. As a consequence, cybersecurity has become a critical business success factor. And now you may ask yourself, how do we tackle all these new requirements? Yeah, during this webinar, we will share lots of experience we've gathered during our client projects. And one thing we want to highlight upfront, taking the uncertainty and time pressure into account, we always recommend that you focus on your big picture topics now and keep the flexibility to adapt to the final requirements. And as we've now touched the regulatory side, we will now deep dive into some of our big picture topics we see at our clients.
Thank you, Jan. So let's move forward directly into the section, industry trends and developments. And before you share the first market observation that we have, Jan, let me share some guidance to start for everyone involved here, especially if you're maybe starting out and getting more and more familiar with this. Some documents that can provide guidance. So on the top left, in the first column, of course, there's the draft regulation itself. So this, of course, is very worthwhile to read and understand. It contains, since the latest update from early this year, an NX5, which has now a list of threats and mitigations that need to be considered during the development. So this is fairly recent and of course has an impact on your development. And also important to be aware of, these threats and mitigations also include back-end systems in this case. So it's moved beyond the pure vehicle focus. The draft regulation references an interpretation document, which is developed by the same task force. While it's not formally part of the regulation itself, it lists those same requirements again and then provides an explanation of each requirement and examples of how to provide evidence. So this is also very worthwhile to read and to be aware of, in particular because it consistently refers to the ISO SAE 21434. So actually since the last update from last week from the latest task force meeting, it states in the early on in this interpretation document that the 21434 can be very supportive in implementing the CSMS requirements along the supply chain. So this is how these documents are connected. What you've also noticed is quite helpful for OEMs. I mentioned before this test phase, which was set up for OEMs and technical services. There are some public test phase reports. You can find one document ID here from the task force website, which is public. You can download it. These are quite interesting. And some OEMs from some technical services also received individual test phase reports. And these have actually always also proven very insightful for this OEM to exactly understand where they are and to define the path forward. And now, Jan, let's share some of the topics we've experienced and observed again and again.
Yeah, indeed. So the first big picture topic is the relation of cybersecurity and information security. We've had multiple client meetings where this was one of the key focus topics. We are frequently asked, is information security management system the same than cybersecurity management system? Is it something completely different? How do we integrate both management systems? And these are very obvious questions. Maybe first of all, take a look at the objectives. They're, to be fair, different. They have different primary objectives. First of all, the CSMS is protecting road vehicles and road users, where, on the other hand, the ISMS is focusing and its core objective is to protect informational assets. But on the other hand, for sure, they're both management systems, security management systems, and share similar frameworks, domains, processes. What needs to be taken into account? First of all, implementations must adapt to automotive and vehicle specifics with their particular objectives. And what we noticed within our sessions is that this brings many different stakeholders together who speak different languages with different backgrounds and who are used to different requirements.
So exactly like the ISO 27000 series or TSACs on the more classical information security side and standards like the ISO 26262 or ASPICE on the development side. So these are just very also different kinds of how you phrase requirements, and now we see these worlds coming together and needing to learn from each other how they work.
Exactly, and all of these requirements and stakeholders are relevant, and as modern vehicles rely more and more upon IT, the IT department has become product relevant with direct customer impact. So one of the key questions is how do we bring all the stakeholders together and where do we draw the boundary of the ISMS and the CSMS? And how do we arrange the overlap between both most efficiently? And I recall a meeting with you, Moritz, with a client, I think it was 5 months ago, where IT, information security, production, product development, and quality management sits together at one table. And with their different backgrounds and requirements, we're discussing this topic. And even though it might be a tough challenge, this is also part of the solution during the journey to derive your tailored CSMS approach. And if we now move forward with this given background, key is also that for this journey, you need to integrate cybersecurity into your life cycle. And to do this, the PDCA cycle is applied and part of each and every management system and CSMS as well. And moving forward with this slide, first of all, I will focus and discuss the implication of the CSMS on enterprise layer, whereas Moritz will outline the implication for the project layer. But first of all, let me briefly summarize for those ones who are not familiar with the PDCA cycle, what is it about? The PDCA cycle stands for Plan, Do, Check, Act cycle and is a core element of management system, of each and every management system to achieve continuous improvement. Within the plan phase, you define your strategy and scope, objectives and KPIs and derive your measures. Within the do phase, you implement those measures in order to trigger reaction to the system. In the check phase, you analyze impact to the system. And in the act phase, you define actions to the system based upon the analysis in order to trigger this improvement. And it's not a one-time activity. It's a continuous life cycle. And as such, you trigger continuous improvement. And this is the main objective. And one example for the PDCA cycle and CSMS, and by the way, which also shows very good the relationship between ISMS and CSMS we just discussed on the previous slides, regards the asset management. Asset management is core piece and essential for operating each and every information security management system. Otherwise, you won't achieve transparency on your most critical information, the related cyber risks, and how you may tackle this exercise with security measures during your whole operations. And same applies with CSMS. Within a CSMS and in accordance to the PDCA, you need a proper continuous software asset management from concept up to post-production and decommissioning. You only need to know which software on a vehicle type is deployed. You need to have transparency and be able to extract each software and their versions for every vehicle in the field over the whole lifetime. And this is just due to the fact that security changes for each component and software during operations. For instance, think of exploits to specific software versions running on a component. And as a consequence, for sure, you need to be capable to identify those potential vulnerabilities and assess the impact on your threat landscape and finally act upon it. And that's the PDCA cycle in turn. Moritz, may you outline the implications for the project layer?
Thank you, Jan. And it's also fascinating here. So it's maybe different language, but we see a similar thing as the PDCA cycle, of course, also on the project or product layer. So this requirement to have a security for the entire life cycle from development all the way to post-production means that cybersecurity needs to go beyond concept and development. And this means potentially new teams and processes and tools need to be set up. So what we see in many client discussions when the CSMS program starts within the classical automotive development department, that this is now a challenge to set up these new teams, processes, and tools. And of course, it makes sense to start in that domain and the concept in development, because here traditionally a lot of automotive-specific security engineering is already taking place. You can leverage quality processes, you can leverage experience from safety, and so on. But the challenge is now how to provide this continuous protection, this continuous monitoring. This will be then one of the bigger challenges. Similar like the PDCA cycle also closes the loop. This will also happen here. This is also what we see. So when you go into security operations and the monitoring, of course, there will be a demand for fast and quick iterations back through the concept in development stage. For example, in case of a cyber attack and an incident, to do a delta risk analysis with the new information, to do a delta security concept, to close the hole, to do delta security implementations, and of course, the testing for the software update. And this, of course, then also puts additional demand on the concept and development stage itself. And finally, this life cycle security impacts the customer-supplier relationship. So we've been part of quite a number of discussions so far, and as I mentioned, these analyzed quite a number of requirements documents now that that show that it's not about a one-time activity. Security is now a continuous relationship between customer and supplier.
Indeed, and this is another big picture topic. Integrating cybersecurity into your lifecycle is not limited to your enterprise. You need to manage cybersecurity with your suppliers. And this is not a one-time activity as previously outlined. Security changes over the whole lifetime. And as a consequence, you need a constant, continuous activity exchange between you and your supplier. And second, you need to manage the security of your supplier in order to match the target security level of your product. Or vice versa, if the maturity state of your supplier is not equivalent, but even worse, you're not capable achieving the desired security level of your product. And your overall CSMS is ultimately not effective. Moritz, may you briefly summarize this section on the
back? Sure. So these were some of the lessons learned from ongoing programs. Of course, there's more to discuss, and I think this would be its own webinar. But as I mentioned in the beginning, please feel free to contact your local KPMG or ASCRIP contact to set up in-depth follow-up discussions. But what have we shared in this section today? So first of all, the CSMS relies on many stakeholders working together efficiently. I mean, this is obviously true, but we notice it's really a situation, it's really a challenge for many clients and many programs we see. The lifecycle security also another big topic. So it puts additional demands on the concept in development, but it also put demands beyond concept in development. It also impacts this customer and supplier relationship. There are many, many discussions now taking place at multiple levels, how to figure out how this will look in the future and what's the best setup. And this also leads to the third topic we shared, this active management of stakeholder maturity. So this is really needed to optimize the invests you make in your own CSMS program to make sure the supply chain and the stakeholders are up to par. And all of these topics we shared today are not just purely technology topics or only pure process topics. So our recommendation at the end of this section is treat cybersecurity really as a transformation project on all three dimensions, people, process, and technology. And this is actually one of the launching points we also had internally in the partnership to set up a new framework to optimize your cybersecurity approach. The framework we've developed is called PROOF, and we will have a look at this now. So what were the initial ideas? I'm sharing this list again of activities from regulatory and standardization bodies happening worldwide. So when we sat down, we collected some of the requirements that should be fulfilled by any such framework. So first of all, it should be unified. To really master the complexity of this regulatory landscape, it would be too much effort to go after each individual framework and regulation. So there should be a unified approach to this, which of course needs traceability. Of course, you need to provide evidence that you fulfill the individual framework standards, regulations that are relevant to you and your business. So there needs to be a traceability. This framework also needs to be adaptable. So we've seen in client discussions, there's no one size fits all. Different customers, not only between OEM and suppliers, but also between brand images, the corporate strategy, they will put a different focus on different parts of the security lifecycle, be it very strong maturity in security engineering or very strong maturity in incident response, to give two examples. And this, of course, leads to the fourth point. Such a framework should allow measurements of maturity to be able to plan an increasing level to get to your target level, also to measure the maturity of your stakeholders. And this is what we've put together into what we call the Product Security Organization Framework, or short PROOF. It consists of five domains. You see in the outer circle, classical security management domains, the cybersecurity management. Here you will find strategy, governance, audit review, and so on. You will find on the bottom the ecosystem, meaning the stakeholder management, supply chain security, distributed cybersecurity activities. Then in the middle circle, the concept in development and production operation, classical, very product-focused security domains, and at the heart of it all, of course, the risk management. And of course, all of it is connected with each other and has subdomains and subtasks associated with it. So this is the framework that we've set up, and we're basing it on a proven methodology how to roll out such a framework and such management systems, which Jan will now introduce to you.
Yes, indeed. So the framework comes along with an approach in order to roll out CSMS and achieve vehicle security type approval. The methodology itself is divided into two layers, enterprise layer rather covering the CSMS and the product layer in order to achieve vehicle security type approval. And each layer consists of several phases and building blocks, and the whole methodology is built up on our experience implementing security management systems in small and large organizations. And as such, it is very much similar to the approach we use when we are implementing an ISMS. It consists, in terms of the CSMS, consists of three major steps: the preparation, the implementation, and the commissioning. Whereas the focus of the preparation phase is you need to start with defining your strategy and scope and move forward with stock taking, so conduct a gap analysis in order to derive a roadmap for your further implementation and commissioning phases. So it will be split into short-term, mid-term, and long-term initiatives in order to operate a certifiable CSMS. Based upon this roadmap, you will start the implementation phase, and within the implementation phase, you will define and implement your target operating model, so your organization structures, your processes, your KPIs, your controls, your policies, your standards. You will define and implement your risk management approach, define your risk appetite within. You will define and implement the people and tools you require, for instance, the competencies, resources. And as well, you need to manage your ecosystem, and as such, need to identify the threat landscape and prioritize your suppliers in order to manage cyber risk along the supply chain. And once it is implemented, in accordance to the PDCA cycle, it's not yet operated. You need to run through a full plan, do, check, act cycle. And as such, you always start with monitoring. So you need to check your measures, so based upon your KPIs, process KPIs, your internal controls, but as well maybe on execution of internal and supplier audits, lessons learned sessions, and so forth. You will identify improvement measures, which in turn needs to be implemented in the continuous improvement phase. And once you've run through these plan to check act phase, you're in a stage where CSMS might be certifiable. Apart from this, your CSMS also needs to be applied to each and every project. And as such, we also defined several phases within this approach as well. And we always start with a type approval readiness. Within your, we are reviewing the EE architecture in order to see gaps from technical perspective and give you a rough indication, for instance, on your required budget. And from there on, it's totally linked to the ISO 21434 standard, where you start conducting risk assessment, integrating cybersecurity in the concept and development phase, and execute your cybersecurity assessments in order to achieve the type approval. But still, as already outlined, to follow the PDCA cycle as well, you integrate after production to post-production within the operation phases. And what we now do is we want to highlight certain building blocks out of this methodology. And we start with audit and readiness checks. Moritz, do you want to deep dive into this topic?
Of course, the whole methodology is too big and would probably be its own webinar. So what we want to do is highlight some steps, and as Jan, as you said, the audit. So we want to give you some insights, how we do it, how we apply it in projects, for example, how we've done these audits in ongoing projects. This slide in itself, of course, there's a lot to unpack and discuss. Again, we're happy to set up follow-up meetings, reach out to your local KPMG or S-Script contact that you have, and we'll set up follow-up meetings. But the reason why we want to talk about this audit is that it's important from our point of view to do a proper setup of the program. So there's often the question, how long will the whole CSMS program run? How much effort is this? What are our gaps? And this is what such an audit can do. Such an audit, even at the start, can identify the gaps, but also very much so identify strengths. So we have not met a client who does not already have some puzzle pieces available, even if you're just starting out on your CSMS journey. You might have really strong safety experience, which you can leverage and, of course, translate to cybersecurity. There might also be strong quality management system. There might be an ISMS in your enterprise IT department. So there are various puzzle pieces that we identify in this analysis, and this is why we also call it the fit gap analysis, not just a gap analysis. And this then yields a targeted roadmap that leverages existing strengths as much as possible to get you there so much faster. And going into the later phases, of course, this also provides an evolutionary path to set up a full maturity monitoring system in your organization in a standardized way. So these audits are standardized, they follow a certain format, a defined format, so you can compare between different times, different milestones. You could also do industry benchmarking. So this is the first topic we wanted to share today. So Jan, maybe let's look at people and tools.
Yeah, thanks. So people and tools for sure goes far beyond to what I will now explain, but we will pick up the training topic as part of this building block, as this is one of the most requested work packages we see at our clients. And it's a very good example for tailoring a CSMS and adjusting it to your strategy and your target maturity level. For sure, there's no one-size-fits-all approach. It should be always tailored to your individual competence management and your current state of the CSMS. We have year-long experience in designing and conducting tailored training approaches, from on-site training for your core CSMS team up to web-based training for the rollout, or even systematic approaches combining different training methods and contents reflecting the target audience for your whole organization, which is rather covering a very strategic vision of your CSMS. And what we do see, and is totally reasonable, is that you start with focusing your training activities for your core team first in order to enable them, and afterwards following the organization. But let's also briefly discuss a core piece of our methodology on project level. Moritz, do you want to explain our approach for type approval readiness checks?
Yes, thank you. So very much like I just talked about audits, which are focusing on the organizational level, on the processes that have been set up relative to the 21434, this type approval readiness is more on the technology level. Because now that cybersecurity is mandatory or will be mandatory with the upcoming regulation, and especially with this Annex 5, which explicitly lists threats and mitigations, we increasingly see the question, what needs to be done on a technical level? Where are the gaps? Is the security that has been planned so far on an EE architecture for a vehicle type, is this sufficient? What kind of budget is needed to close the gaps, if there are any? And this is what we address with this type approval readiness. It's in a workshop style, followed by a report, which is based on input from, of course, the draft regulation, the interpretation document, what we've seen in the test phase, and, of course, our combined experience in security engineering. So it will give an initial budget estimation how far away, let's say, the current security concepts are from what can be expected based on these documents, on these sources for a type approval. And this works quite well in our experience and leads then often to quite fruitful and constructive discussions.
Yes, maybe let me briefly summarize the section on optimizing your approach with our framework for proof. KPMG and SDRIPT has developed proof, a framework in order to master cybersecurity in an increasingly complex ecosystem. And this framework is a unified traceable cybersecurity maturity framework to support our clients in the vehicle cybersecurity journey end to end. And it consists of several building blocks. One core piece, or the core building blocks, are all around audits and readiness checks, either on enterprise as well as on project layer. And those checks yield to targeted roadmaps for CSMS and VTA programs. And second, one of the key features of the framework is that it helps to adapt to individual maturity, security strategy, and brand positioning. And to achieve CSMS certification and vehicle type approval, you need to run through a transformation, that's for sure. And therefore, and that is what our current projects already illustrate, is that we always recommend that you build on internal strengths where possible, but still for sure leverage external expertise and capacity where needed. And by the way, your whole journey up to there will not be limited to the topics just discussed. You may cross further topics closely related to it, and Moritz, you will briefly discuss them in the last section.
Yeah, so let's just take a very brief look, as promised, beyond CSMS and vehicle type approval, for two reasons. So first of all, because this is where we feel such a unified framework really pays off, but also because we see this in the customer projects. And it's individual selections each, so it depends really on the individual company, but or the individual client. But next to the CSMS, I imagine quite a few of you are familiar that there is a twin regulation developed by the same task force on software update management systems, the SUMS or SUMS. And there's also, like the 21434, an ISO standard in development, 20089. Jan, you mentioned asset management, there are the auto-ISEC best practices, there is the NIST directive in the EU. So there are lots of topics related to cybersecurity and this complex compliance landscape that in the future need to be considered and tackled. And this is where we feel, again, such a unified framework can be useful develop, let's say, a long-term roadmap. In the first step, of course, the focus for most of the clients that we see for the biggest chunk of the market is to be compliant, of course, to the regulation. And then, based on the experience we have from other industries, it will turn into a question of increasing efficiency, increasing return on invest of what you spend on these cybersecurity management systems. And in the end, it might lead to actually going into the direction of strategic cybersecurity, where you get an even bigger return on invest by aligning the cybersecurity topic to other frameworks, to your corporate mission, to the overall strategy. But I don't want to take up too much of the time on this, and instead open the floor to your questions. So thank you a lot.